Good evening. Thank you for coming and filling this auditorium in order to welcome our two guests tonight, Ellery Schempp, whose protest against the use of the state-sponsored King James Bible in his Pennsylvania school of, in Abington Township became the critical point in the U.S. Supreme Court's addressing of the issue of whether state-sponsored schools violates the establishment clause of the First Amendment of the U.S. Constitution. And also Professor Mark Chancey from the Department of Theology and the School of Humanities at Southern Methodist University, who's come here to talk to us about one of the results, which has been Texas and other schools across the country experimenting with various types of programs, biblical education, and whether those actually meet the standards of the First Amendment and U.S. Supreme Court's decisions. We are here tonight as a result of the decisions of Nancy Friedman and Americans United for the Separation of Church and State, the Houston chapter, which welcomes all of you here and is also looking for people interested in exploring such issues and defending such rights in the future, and therefore there are materials here for anyone who would like to participate in similar discussions and programs to join the Houston chapter of Americans United for Separation of Church and State in the future. We also thank our many friends who've made this possible. Without further ado, I'm going to turn to Ellery, and he will take my place here at the podium, and I will work through this PowerPoint that will present some of the issues so that you can read along and see some of the things, some of the interesting adventures in Ellery's life before we go on to some of the analyses that come from the teaching Professor Chancey. So, Ellery, please take my place. My name is David Furlow, and I've litigated First Amendment issues in the courts here in the Southern District of Texas, up through the U.S. Supreme Court and in the state district courts, too. And I'm as fervent of a believer in First Amendment freedoms as Nancy or anybody else who's brought you this on behalf of Americans United for Separation of Church and State. Thank you.
Nice introduction. I'm quite honored to be here to help Americans United of Houston to celebrate 20 years of action to preserve separation of church and state. My partner Arlene and I flew down from Boston on Saturday, where you may have heard about all the snow. We actually live in Medford, a suburb which is famous in its own right. It's where James Pierpont wrote the song, the well-known Christmas song, Jingle Bells. And it's where Amelia Earhart used to live. It is true that the snow is piled up to small mountains in front of our home, but millions of boys and girls love snow. You know, in all of the Bible, the Koran, the Bhagavad Gita, Holy Scriptures everywhere, there's not a single mention of snowballs. But I did read on the internet this morning that, in my opinion, this is a quote from Free Republic right-wing blog. In his opinion, it's God punishing us in Massachusetts punishing the people of Boston for electing Elizabeth Warren and the other godly pro-gay, pro-abortion communists. So I'm glad to be among them. Well, I guess I should be thrilled or something to be where Rick Perry and Ted Cruz are from. And the infamous Texas Board of Education, where all kinds of textbooks are mismanaged. So you good guys have a lot to be worried about.
Ellery, I'm going to review a few slides to give the people in the audience an opportunity to explore the interesting history of your life that you and I have shared over the past few weeks. So I'll go back to the very beginning about, you know, where you were born and how you came to be a part of Abington Township.
Sure.
Specifically, can you tell us, you know, what it was like growing up in Abington Township over Pennsylvania?
Well, Abington is a suburb of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania.
It's a typical suburban middle-class town. The high school, the thing that made Pennsylvania unique in this regard was that there was a law that had been on the books for 80 years or more that required that 10 verses of the Holy Bible be read, caused to be read, at the beginning of each school day without comment in every school classroom throughout the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. So that was a practice that had been part of my life from the time I came to Roslyn Elementary School and went on to Abington Junior High and Abington Senior High School. And one day in 1958, I objected. I thought that this was a clear violation of the First Amendment. The First Amendment, says quite clearly, Congress shall make no law respecting establishment of religion nor prohibiting the free exercise thereof. Well, this was clearly an establishment of a Christian religious practice, at the very least. And it was not a Muslim practice, it was not a Hindu practice, it was not an atheist practice. So it seemed to me that was a violation.
And were you a member of the Unitarian Church at that time?
I grew up as a member of the Unitarian Church in Philadelphia. It's a free-thinking liberal church. And it was very significant that they were very concerned about social justice in many different domains. And one of those, and one aspect of that was that I was familiar with the American Civil Liberties Union.
All right. And did you have an opportunity about then to engage in some required 10 verses of Bible reading in your class?
Well, the way it was the Bible reading was carried out, of course, in the younger grades, the teacher had to read the Bible. But by seventh grade or junior high, teachers got quite tired of this. And so at the beginning of the class of the year, school year, they would say, Charlie, you read the Bible this morning, and Susie, you read it tomorrow, and we'll go around the classroom one by one. So, you know, well, you would get to class at 8:15 in the morning, not quite awake maybe, and somebody would remember that, oh, it's your turn to read the Bible. Nobody ever remembered it on their own. And so you stumbled around the room and looked for the Bible, which was always the King James Version. The law didn't say it had to be, but that's the way it was in practice. And then kids who knew very little about the Bible, which is almost everyone, just would open it at random, just completely at random. And all you had to do was stumble through 10 verses, and you had done your duty, and then the rest of the class stood up and recited the Lord's Prayer, which was not part of the law, and then the flag salute, of course. So that was the way Bible reading was practiced, and it struck me as the readings, of course, were incoherent. The Bible is not an easy, the King James Version, the old English phraseology, is not an easy thing to read. So the reading was generally extremely poor. And since it began nowhere and ended nowhere, it meant absolutely nothing.
And what did this practice of reading 10 verses, what did that get when it came to you?
Well, there were sometimes when funny things would happen. I have one kid, I remember in ninth grade, I think, stumbled on for the begets. So, at the beginning of the book, of the Gospels, it tells the lineage of Jesus. And somebody begat somebody who begat somebody who begat. These begettings go on for quite a good bit. And so the next day, another kid picked it up and started reading more begats. This went on for 3 or 4 days. And finally, the teacher said, look, no more of this begatting. I think begatting, of course, suggests various other activities that Meyer could not in favor of in terms of the abstinence education. So, and interestingly enough, at that point, the teacher had actually broken the law because he had made a comment. And the whole idea of reading the Bible without comment was to prevent different interpretations according to different denominations so that it couldn't be changed to the charge that was in any way discriminatory. But on the other hand, this also illustrates another very important point. It was discriminatory in the following sense. The Catholic position had never been that people should read the Bible on their own, but the Catholic position from the earliest times had been that the priest would read the Bible, and of course in that day, it's basically be written in Latin or any other language, because the average person didn't read that. And then the priest would interpret it for the masses. It was Martin Luther in the Protestant Reformation that presented the idea that every man should read the Bible on his own and come to his own conclusion. So the whole thing was intrinsically discriminatory between Protestant denominations, and between Protestants and Catholics and Orthodox. Of course, there's 10 or 20 different Christian sects, the Manichaeans, the Copts, many others, but that's the way it is.
Okay, and when you began reading the Bible on your own, did you stumble across at any point Book of Solomon?
The beginning was so much fun. But I did actually search out the Psalm of Solomon, which is a love story, a very romantic story, and it's a little bit sexy. And I was 14 years old, and under the authority of the school, when you read passages like, thy breasts were like two doves in the morning dew, I mean, this is pretty heady stuff.
How would your teacher react to your particular instance?
Well, they really couldn't say anything. It's in the Bible, for heaven's sake.
So, time progresses, and November 26, 1956 comes around. Can you tell us about what happened on that?
I had decided to make a protest about the Bible reading because I thought it was a violation of the First Amendment and a violation of the rights of kids. And I had a number of really close friends and a very interesting group that we call ourselves the Thursday Evening Discussion Group that grew out of our honors English class. And we had talked about lots of different ideas. And at first it seemed like we might get two or three or four of us to all join in making a protest. But as the other George and Vera and others in the class, in our group, talked to their parents, there was clearly a lot of negatives flying around. And so on the one day, I decided that it was going to be me or no, going to be nobody. I had borrowed a copy of the Koran from my friend George's father's library. I didn't know anything about the Koran or Islam, and I didn't know anybody else did either. But I just knew that it was another so-called holy scripture. And my only point was to show that there were other holy scriptures, not only the Bible was not unique. It could have been the Bhagavad Gita or Shinto scriptures, but that was what was available. So I brought it to school, and the school rule was that you had to pay strict attention during the Bible reading. So you had to put all your other books away and not read, do your finish up your altar homework and whatever. So I sat there and read the Koran to myself quietly, and I didn't stand up for the Lord's Prayer. Well, that's got their notice. So I jumped to my feet and did the light salute and sat down. Well, the teacher came over to me right away and said, Ellery, what's going on here? You know, you have to obey the school rules. And I said, well, as a matter of conscience, I can no longer participate in these morning devotions. And then the religious nature was very clear from the fact that they were called morning devotions. He was very puzzled. I had always been a good student. I was never arrested for smoking in the bathroom and that sort of thing. So he sent me to the principal, who was equally baffled. Eugene Stull, I remember rather unfondly. He didn't know what to make of it either, and he lectured me on respect and the fact that there were 1,100 other kids in the class, in the high school, that were carrying out the doing all the things properly, and why couldn't I simply conform? This was 1956. Not many of you were around at that time, but that was an era in which conformity was put forth as one of the highest goals of humankind, and students in particular. Conform, don't make waves. The Man in the Gray Flannel Suit was a popular book. So the principal couldn't make any sense out of this, is why I did everything he thought he knew. So he sent me to the guidance counselor. Obviously, he had a disturbed young man on his hands. The guidance counselor was equally puzzled and spent a good bit of time trying to figure out whether I was having some difficulties at home, whether I was having difficulties with my father, whether I was having difficulties with authority, just what kind of difficulties I was having. I said, I didn't have any difficulties with anybody. My father and I got along very nicely. I just had a disagreement about Bible reading.
And the principal, what did he do in the weeks afterwards?
Well, it was a kind of truce was worked out, because they didn't really know what they were getting up into. I didn't either, for that matter. That evening I came home and I wrote a letter to the American Civil Liberties Union. And this is one of the facts. Sometimes when you get involved in something like this, which is much larger than yourself, it's just because you're damn lucky. And I was lucky. I grew up in this humanitarian environment, which is free thinking. We had learned the idea that in the Sunday school at age 7 or 8 or something, we, in the Unitarian church, we went to Sunday school kids were taken to other churches, to the Jewish synagogues, to Methodist, the Lutheran, Baptist, even Baptist. So that we would learn what they were thinking. And it quickly sorted out in my view that there was no single path to truth, that there were many different ideas, and nobody could claim to know the sole truth and have a particular relationship to God at the expense of their benefit over everybody else. So that was important. And the fact that the ACLU existed, known to me, so I sat down and with two fingers typed out a letter to the American Civil Liberties Union and sent it off, together with a $10 bill. That was very important because the ACLU in Philadelphia was feeling very poor, and they were harboring their funds for dealing with the remnants of the McCarthy era. They had to realize that that was waning at that time. It turns out that the $10 was worth about $90 in today's money, I understand. And they thought that was pretty nifty, that if a kid could save up that amount of money from his allowance and his chores, then he might be pretty serious. So, but then of course it took a long time for them to sort through whether this was a serious issue, and whether the Schempp family were kooks, and whether exactly they should do about it.
And here we have a copy of the letter that you made available to us, so that everybody can see that in some instances the mightiest of oaks grow from the smallest of acorns. There you are. Can you tell us how the litigation went after you sent the letter to the ACLU?
Well, it took quite some time. The ACLU did a lot of internal considerations, and they interviewed our family several times. And incidentally, it's very important that I have a younger brother, Roger, and a younger sister, Donna. But eventually, they decided they would file suit. Bernie Wolfman was their original intended lawyer. Bernie Wolfman made a very personal sacrifice and said, because I'm Jewish, I don't think I should take this case. And so they finally found Henry W. Sawyer III, who was a well-known lawyer for famous Philadelphia law firm, Bricker Bimble and Roth. And he served pro bono and put together a wonderful brief, which was submitted to the federal district court. In those days, when you had a challenge to a federal constitutional issue, a special three-judge district court would be convened, and the appeal from this court would be directly to the Supreme Court, bypassing entirely the Court of Appeals. That law has since been changed as a result of the civil rights movement. That's a long story. So on August 5th of 1958, this judge convened the Philadelphia District Courthouse. And I remember it very well because it happened to be my birthday. So I suggest that any time you have a court issue, you should always choose it to be on your birthday.
And in fact, I put up there on the screen some of the issues that arose out of this suit, which I think are still issues when people consider, people make arguments about whether we should return to the era of school prayers, the various issues presented in your case and written about in the book Ellery's Protest about your lawsuit.
Yeah, I strongly recommend this book to people who might be interested. I'd invite it. The author is Stephen Solomon from New York University. I didn't choose the title, but I don't get any royalties from it. But it's a very thorough and well written account that I urge anybody who's interested in the case to learn about and read about.
It's a fun read. It's a good read.
What's the name?
Oh, the title of the book is Ellery's Protest.
Now, one of the issues that was the subject of presentation of evidence and expert opinions was about the King James Bible as opposed to other Bibles. Can you comment on the issue of which Bible should be the one that would be read, and the school district officials were the proper persons to make that decision?
Well, both sides, of course, the way this is done, you file a civil lawsuit, a criminal suit, and we challenge the townships of Pennsylvania to justify the practice and to claim that they should be prohibited from carrying out this Bible reading and prayer business on the right grounds of the United States Constitution. We file in the federal district court. That's generally a good strategy because if you file it in state courts are reluctant to declare unconstitutional state laws. So this gave us a little bit of an advantage. And so our side had as an expert witness, Dr. Solomon Grizel, a noted rabbi and Jewish scholar in Philadelphia. And their side had a retired dean of theology from Yale Law School, Dean Weigel. And so both sides were, both experts were asked. And I was asked, and all the members of our family were asked, were there any things in the Bible that we particularly objected to? And the answer was yes. We do not believe in the Trinity. We do not believe in whether the Trinity is actually in the Bible is a matter of dispute by itself. But we didn't believe in the Virgin Birth. We didn't believe in the resurrection and the Easter story. And, lots of things. There's lots of things in the Bible we don't have to believe in. And we didn't believe in most of them. So, That part was easy. But then the expert testimony was, Solomon Wiesel testified that readings from the New Testament had often been extremely hurtful to Jewish kids over the years. And we all know that the anti-Semitic riots and anti-Semitic activities of many kinds, which justified, perhaps wrongly, but nonetheless justified, by quoting various passages in the Bible. So that, that was definitely hurtful. And I remember the Jewish kids in my class looking obviously uncomfortable, or even talking about feeling uncomfortable, feeling left out, feeling discriminated against. When certain passages that typically come up around Easter time or around Christmas time were read. So, it was very powerful testimony.
And did the experts talk about the other Bibles that had been?
Well, and this is very sort of amusing too. We were talking about the Catholic view about Bible reading. Very few people seem to know that there is a Catholic version of the Bible. It's known as the Douay Rheims translation interpretation. And it differs quite substantially from the Protestant Bibles. And the Protestant Bibles are numerous, by the way. King James version, everybody knows, but there's a new international version, a revised something or other version, there are versions and versions and versions. And different denominations take different views on them, which Bible is the best one of them. When Martin Luther translated the Bible from Latin Vulgate into German, he left out a number of books that were in the Catholic Bible that had been there for years. When the Catholics finally got around to writing an English version, they of course included the old books. So the Catholic Bible has a different number of books, has different numberings of the Ten Commandments, has different translations of some of the verses, and it was noticeable in school because the Catholics would recite a slightly different version of the Lord's Prayer than the Protestants would. So the idea that one size of religion fits all became obviously absurd. You could not possibly believe that one size fits all.
And specifically, your background in Philadelphia, did you study in the history there of Pennsylvania and differences over religious views as established in these different Bibles?
Well, it's a bit of history, rather sad bit of history. In 1844 in Philadelphia, there were riots over Bible reading. Can you imagine it? There were riots in the street, churches were burned, and men were killed. And the issue was Bible reading. Now, the context is a little bit more, takes a little understanding, because Protestant Bible had been used in the schools from the earliest times in the New World here, colonies, in one form or another. But there had been relatively few Catholics among the early immigrants. In the middle of the 19th century, a lot of new immigrants came from Italy and Ireland who were Catholics. And so they objected to having the Bible, the Protestant Bible, read to them in the public schools. So that's what precipitated these riots. There was some anti-immigration feeling, anti-immigrant feeling, of course, mixed up in all this. But the riots were so severe that the governor of Pennsylvania had to call out the National Guard to put them down. And the riots went on for 3 or 4 days. And it was a very nasty business. But as a result of this, the Catholic Archbishop of Philadelphia said that Catholics will never be able to get a fair shake in the public schools, and that's why we should start the Catholic school system, and that was actually the beginning of the parochial school system. It was a dispute over Bible reading in the schools.
So if we actually consider issues of separation of church and state, when we look back at the King James Bible, this slide here, the introduction of it, what does the King James Bible, what type of issues did that raise with respect to you and your views about church and state and their separation?
Well, as I mentioned, I didn't believe that the Bible, that any version of the Bible should have had a place in public schools. So which version was the most offensive was not the real issue.
And I'll tell you that one of the reasons that Ellery went to the U.S. Supreme Court was because of the difference of viewpoints from the states. He filed a petition for certiorari in Latin for it to make more certain. And that is because there were serious issues about violation of church and state that arose throughout the United States and different states. And as Professor Chancey will tell you, still, are the subject of controversies to this day. Here, for example, is a copy of the King James Bible that Sam Houston acquired in New York on his one trip up there in 1921. And this is also the Bible on which every justice of the Texas Supreme Court has sworn his oath of office to the present time. Briefly, the line of cases that required certiorari was there were more cases that held that Bible reading and seeing the biblical verses was constitutional in various states, often with elected judges, than there were cases holding to the contrary. In our own Texas, in 1908, the Texas Supreme Court, three-person panel, all male, all Protestant, considered a case brought by two Catholics, two free thinkers, and two Jews who were all, except of course, Canada Independent School District, using tax money to run a state-sponsored school fair program. Texas Supreme Court heard the matter on an expedited basis and without dissent, held that, quote, to hold it, the offering of prayers, either by the repetition of the Lord's Prayer or otherwise, the singing of songs from the King James Bible, and the reading of the King James Bible, make the place where such is done a place of worship, would produce intolerable results. So the court said it does not follow that one or more individuals have the right to have the courts deny the people the privilege of having their children instructed in the moral truths of the Bible, because such objectors do not desire that their own children shall be participants therein. This would be to starve the moral and spiritual natures of the many out of deference to the few. And this Texas Supreme Court from 1908 is typical of those cases throughout the country, and particularly in the American South, that held that reading the King James Bible was perfectly constitutional, and that's what set up the need for Hillary, as he saw it, for Ellery, as he saw it, to file a certiorari petition to the U.S. Supreme Court. And here, he will tell you that the ACLU and Americans United participated in the court in their various ways.
Well, so in the course of time, the district court decided 3-0 that we were correct and declared the Pennsylvania law unconstitutional. The school district then appealed it to the Supreme Court, that's certiorari, and the court began to consider it. But in the meanwhile, the Pennsylvania State Legislature, in its wisdom, had deliberately misread the federal district court decision. We won on both grounds, but it's a violation of the Establishment Clause. Congress will make no establishment of religion. And of course, it established a Judeo-Christian practice at the very least. And that prohibited the free exercise because there was no provision for a child to be excused from the practice. So the legislature ignored the establishment issue and, to great ceremony, passed a law that allowed a child to be excused. The law passed 399-1. So the Supreme Court generally tries to talk very controversial issues, and so they sent it back to the district court and said for rehearing in the light of the change. So that essentially started the whole case over again, and it's 2 years later.
And then it went up to the U.S. Supreme Court again?
Then it went up to the Supreme Court again. Well, and we won a second time at the district court level on the same two grounds, I claim. And it was very important. The argument that allowing a child to be excused did not sway the court, because they said that it would require a child to self-identify, get up and, you know, leave the room or something while the Bible reading was being read, and therefore invite taunting and bullying and identifying as a dissenter, as a different person, whatever. So that was a very important part of the decision.
And can you talk about the Engle versus Vitality decision of 1962 that preceded your decision by year?
Well, our case was decided on June 17th of 1963, but the year before, a case known as Engle versus Vitali, brought by a couple families in Long Island, New York, against the New York Board of Regents prayer. And it was a very innocuous prayer that the New York Board had put together that said something to the effect of Almighty God, we acknowledge our dependence upon thee and ask thy blessings, blah, blah, blah. But the court ruled that it was no part of the business of government to be composing prayers. And this is one of my favorite quotes from all these Supreme Court decisions about separation of church and state. Think of that phrase. It is no part of the business of government to be composing prayers. Well, what is the business of government? Isn't it having to do with our roads and our water supply and this and the other thing, and getting the schools to work properly and the school buses and the snow plowing and whatever? That is the business of government. It is no part of the business of government to be having prayers before school board meetings, no part of the business of government to have prayers before city council meetings. That's not the business of government. And that's a famous phrase from the Engle decision.
So this, you know, for the Methodist, this is what Ellery had sent to me that just demonstrates the process through which case goes up on certiorari to reach the U.S. Supreme Court, because it was his decision that ended school prayer practice throughout the country. And School District of Abington Township versus Schempp, 1963, here's the citation. The interesting things to me as a lawyer are that this was an 81 majority. It picked up the most conservative members of the U.S. Supreme Court. It was an easy decision for the U.S. Supreme Court that did not address it before, as opposed to how difficult it would have been if I was politically motivated and elected judges had to address the same issue. And specifically, we might comment on a few of these reasons for it. A few of the decisions, you know, high points there as to their first, the U.S. Supreme Court's first analysis for why the result you sought had to be the law of the land.
Well, the position of the founding fathers, I think, is something I want to focus upon. Most of the founding fathers, the ones that are most famous, were not particularly Christian. They were what a lot of people would describe as deists. But the important point, I think, is that when you think about our Constitution, for example, the Constitution never once mentions Jesus or religion, Christianity mentions religion. The Constitution mentions religion just twice, and both times the word no is attached. So that's pretty important. The first place is in Article 6, where it says there shall be no religious test for holding public office, and of course, I'm just quoting the First Amendment. So it's very important to understand this, that the Constitution, even the oath of office, does not contain the phrase under God. That's been appended, that's been added by various presidents who've taken the oath of office, but if you read Article 6, the oath of office does not contain the phrase under God. The Constitution is written for we the people do ordain and establish this Constitution. That does not call upon divine blessing, does not call upon divine providence, divine help, blessings of any kind. When it comes to taking the oath, they were very careful to use the phrase, I do swear or affirm in taking this oath. Why did they have to add this extra phrase to affirm? It's because in those days, talking about 1790 thereabouts, the idea of swearing had very distinct religious overtones and implications. And so in order to emphasize that there was nothing to be religious about this at all, they added the phrase to affirm, which had nothing to do with religion. So, and I also like to point out that many people think that the Constitution and the Bible are somehow intimately connected. Not so. The Bible never once mentions democracy. The Bible never once mentions freedom of religion. The Bible never once mentions freedom of speech. It doesn't mention elections, or an independent judiciary, or three branches of government. The Bible is not a model for American democracy. It's not a model even for religious freedom and tolerance. It never mentions religious tolerance. So I don't think that we ought to look at the Bible as being the foundation of our Constitution and our government.
Now, can you tell us? Can you tell us how the public reacted to this Supreme Court decision that bore your name?
There was a good bit of outrage. You might say it was of biblical proportions. But I think there was a famous cartoonist for the Washington Post who I think summed it up very nicely. I have to show it to you. This shows this man reading the newspaper headlines over the breakfast table, and he's shouting, what do they expect us to do? Listen to the kids pray at home? That's about precisely it. Why is there this crazy emphasis upon everybody having to pray in school? You could go to church before to school. You can pray at home over the breakfast table. You can pray when you come home from school. Why do you have to pray in school in a public display of prayer and public display of piety? That's what I think it was all about. But there were attempts to amend the Constitution, of course. They all failed. And there are many cases that went on. The Abington case was only one of this whole series of cases that we mentioned. We didn't mention that the McCollum case of 1948, the Engle versus the Polly case of 62, the Abington case, and then Weissman and Griswold and a dozen others, all having to do with expanding the concept that we're not going to have prayers at graduation ceremonies, we're not going to have prayers at football games, we're not going to have religious imposition on use of birth control, that was the Griswold case, and many, many others, all were part of a major revolution, I think, in our thinking about separation of church and state and expanding it. And this grew out of the civil rights movement and civil rights movement in other areas too. I mean, the right of African Americans to vote, to participate in civic life was expanding, and then the rights of non-believers and minority religions had to be expanding at the same time.
Yes. Ellery was kind enough to give me both of her block cartoons that he thought were some of the more amusing reactions to the case decision. And then we have one of the awards that Ellery has received for recognition from the Massachusetts legislature, not the legislature that had been challenged by Ellery's lawsuit. You want to talk about that for a minute?
I'm waiting for one from Texas.
The Lord said not in my lifetime.
You believe in miracles.
Now, some people have tried to point out, you know, have tried to argue that plaintiffs in these First Amendment religious cases are a dour crew, that they are sad and angry against society, that they never accomplish anything. Can you tell us a little bit about your life after the litigation? Beginning with Tufts University?
Well, I went to Tufts, and that was my first foray into New England from the wilds of Philadelphia. And Tufts was a very, very happy environment for me. It's high on a hill overlooking Harvard. And I had the good fortune of running into the geology professor. I studied physics. I started off studying chemistry, then I studied physics, and then I came back and got a Ph.D. in chemical physics. But anyway, but I did a lot of geology as well. And I had a very happy experience with first having a college roommate who introduced me to hiking in the mountains of New Hampshire and Vermont. And then Professor Nichols invited me to take summer jobs in Greenland and the Canadian Arctic. And then invited me to be part of an expedition to South America, to the Antarctica. So I'm probably the only person who's going to meet here this evening who's been to within 400 miles of the North Pole and to within 800 miles of the South Pole. These were thrilling experiences for me as a 19 and 20-year-old guy. But when I applied to Tufts, I had good grades in Abington, so I wasn't too worried about getting into college. And I was the first one of my generation. My parents hadn't gone to college, nor other parts of members of the extended family. I turned out to be the eldest grandson. It turned out that the normal procedure was that the guidance counselor would send out the transcripts and any recommendations you would get from teachers. In my case, my principal insisted that my applications go to his desk before they were sent out. And he wrote, in every case, a letter of disrecommendation for me to every college that I applied to. I didn't know this at the time, actually, that it seemed not to have an influence because I got into every college that I applied to. But Dean Stearns, Dean Charlie Stearns, who was the dean of admissions, and we got to know each other fairly well at Tufts. And he told me this remarkable story one day that it was a matter of courtesy they sent out a letter to the high school saying so-and-so has been admitted to our college. And so when Principal Stoll got this letter, he was furious and infuriated, and picked up the phone and called long distance from Philadelphia to Tufts in Boston. Now, in 1958, calling long distance was an exceptional thing. You only called grandma long distance on her birthday or something. It's expensive, forbearing any expense, and he insisted that Tufts revoke my admission. He claimed that I would be the rotten apple in the barrel, and I would bring disrepute onto the university forever and ever, ever thereafter, to Charlie Stearns' great credit and my admiration. He said to me, Tufts has never regretted their decision.
So did things turn around at Abington Senior High School by the year 2000?
Yeah. Well, when I left Tufts, they were very happy to see the back of me. As time went on, feelings ameliorated a little bit, and in the course of time, quite a lot of time actually, from 1963 to 2002, I think, they finally decided they invited me to become, invited me to be initiated into the Tufts, into the
Abington Senior High School Hall of Fame. The teacher who was in charge of this called me up one day, out of the blue, I never thought of this at all, and said to me, "Well, we want to induct you into the Hall of Fame, but we're not entirely sure what category to put you in. So we decided we would put you in the category of science." Well, I thought that was kind of nice, but I've never really made any tremendous improvements to science. I guess I've done a lot of things I've done. But the one thing I was really noted for was winning the Supreme Court case. And he said, "We're not going to mention that." But he did say, and he was a nice guy, and he said this quite deliberately, he said, "But when you make your acceptance speech, you can say anything you like." So that's how I became a member of the Hall of Fame.
That's excellent. Yes, I've shown a few slides of your background in physics, and could you tell us briefly about the work that you contributed to MRI technology?
Well, I did something called nuclear magnetic resonance, which was a technique that was used by physicists and especially by chemists to understand molecules and molecular bonds and identify molecular compounds. That's what I did as a PhD student at Brown in Providence. And I went from there on to Bell Telephone Labs, where I actually worked on things related to fiber optics. So I was part of a team called the Physical Chemistry Group that learned how to make fiber optics in such a way that they were really useful so that they could carry signals long distances without them being lost. And from there I went on to the University of Pittsburgh, where I had a joint department in the Department of Crystallography and the Department of Physics, and did some more nuclear magnetic resonance, actually a little branch called nuclear probable resonance, but anyway. And from there I went on to, I went mountain climbing actually, in Pakistan, in the Himalayas, and climbed a mountain where I was part of the Pittsburgh Explorers Club group to try to climb Nanga Parbat. It's 26,600 feet. It's the ninth highest mountain in the world. And it had been climbed before, but never by an American team, so we tried to be that. We went over as 14 people, but we only came back as 12. Two of our party were killed in a terrible accident in the mountain. And from there I went to the University of Geneva in Switzerland. That was a fun place to live for a couple of years. I taught at the University of Geneva, where I did research, and at the University American College of Switzerland. And from there I went to work at the Lawrence Berkeley Lab in California, where I worked on nuclear waste disposal problems and things about relating to how you would, if you drill a hole in the ground for either oil or some other purpose, how you could learn about the stresses on the ground for using magnetic resonance techniques and whatever. And from that I went to General Electric and worked on what became an expansion of nuclear magnetic resonance into what we now know as magnetic resonance imaging. So I was one of the early people in working on it. I didn't invent it, but it was fun to be part of this new emerging technology. I've had a lot of interesting experience. I've also worked in high temperature superconductors and superconductive magnets for MRI systems, and I was a consultant to the government of New Zealand on energy issues, and I've had a lot of fun.
And you're still an activist today?
Excuse me?
You're still an activist standing up for your rights today, the rights of the school too?
Yeah, I think the idea of separation of church and state is a very important one, and I'm very happy to be able to lend my energies to keeping it going.
Very well. We're going to have opportunities for questions after Professor Chancey speaks, but Ellery, thank you for coming all the way down here. Now, Professor Mark Chancey has come here from SMU, where he has pioneered research about the way certain laws have been enacted across the country, and particularly here in Texas. He is an author and a leading expert on Texas legislative efforts to promote Bible courses in public schools and the results of those promotional activities. He is engaged in comprehensive studies of real-world experience with various school districts, particularly in Texas, but also across the country, dealing with these type of issues. So, without further ado, I bring you Professor Mark Chancey. I'll throw up here a few slides, and we'll open, the questions to him so he can tell you what he's done But I would tell you that this man is someone who is qualified to speak on these issues, professor of religious studies at SMU, teaches courses on biblical studies, such as Introduction to the New Testament, Pauline Christianity, the world of the New Testament. He's been involved in studies of the historical Jesus. His research interests include the Gospels and the history of religion, and particularly now, the history of religion as it's being taught in Texas. Basically, which may not be the same thing. With respect to his work, of course, I propose a few critical questions for us to consider and for him to address. First of all, do most public school Texas Bible courses, in your opinion, cross the constitutional line by promoting certain religious activities? And if so, what do you base your opinions on?
Okay. Well, I will come to those questions in just a second, making the focal point. I have only a few comments. I know people are eager to ask questions and have the opportunity to interact directly with Ellery. Let me thank the organizers of this event for allowing me to participate. Thank David for moderating, and just a tremendous honor to be on the same program panel as Ellery, a hero and someone who has contributed to all of our religious liberty by taking a very courageous stand at a very young age. The Schempp decision that we've been talking about is absolutely positively foundational for all subsequent church-state litigation, and especially for all subsequent cases on religion and public education. It's absolutely a milestone and a landmark. I want to talk a little bit about why it is so important. And the first is because the principle that it established so clearly that public schools as government entities are to preserve the religious freedom of all students. The issue that the Supreme Court was criticizing was not reading of the Bible for the sake of reading the Bible. It was not a Bible-bashing decision. The decision was about government sponsorship of Bible reading. The use of government funds, government resources, government space to promote certain religious views over others. And it is no business of the government to promote my religion, your religion, or anyone else's religion. When someone's religious views are promoted using government resources over someone else's, and I include atheists, agnostics, and apathetics in the range, when one set of religious views is promoted over others, then all of our religious liberty suffers. So the court was emphatic that the reading of these Bible verses constituted a religious exercise. There was no secular reason to do that. There was no reason for Jewish kids or Roman Catholic kids or agnostic kids to sit through that. So governments, public schools should promote some religious views over others, a foundational principle. But Schempp, the decision, also established another principle that gets much, much less attention, I think, especially in the popular mind. Because along the way, the court very famously affirmed studying about religion. What the court said was, it might well be said that one's education is not complete without a study of comparative religion or the history of religion and its relationship to the advancement of civilization. The court, the same court that was saying the school can't sponsor Bible reading every morning, that same court said, it certainly may be said that the Bible is worthy of study for its literary and historic qualities. The court continued, nothing we have said here indicates that such study of the Bible or of religion, when presented objectively, as part of a secular program of education, may not be effective consistently with the First Amendment. So, prohibition of state-sponsored Bible reading, but affirmation of the study about religion when done from an objective perspective as part of a secular program of education. I would argue that there are strong civic reasons for studying and learning about religion. good reasons to learn about religious diversity in our own society and the religious diversity of an ever-shrinking world. I would argue that religious literacy is an important part of preparation for citizenship. But I would also note, coming to the questions that you asked, that even though the court affirmed the study of religion when done in certain ways, as a society, we have not figured out how to teach and talk about religion in public schools without promoting certain views over others. And that, unfortunately, is what I discovered in my research of Texas Bible classes. When I first got interested in this issue, I discovered how little scholarly literature there was on the details of what actually happens in public school classrooms and teaching about religion, whether teaching about Bible or teaching about oral traditions. So I was very lucky to identify a partner organization with Americans United, Texas Freedom Network, which is based in Austin, TFN.org. Thank you. I proudly serve on the board, and I've done multiple studies with them, and they frequently partner with Americans United, the ACLU, and other groups to preserve religious liberty. TFN said, well, we want to learn what's happening in Texas classrooms when they talk about the Bible. And so they commissioned me to do a couple of studies on Texas Bible courses in which they use freedom of information requests to get the classroom materials for Bible courses taught at the high school level across Texas. And what I found was that, unfortunately, most classes don't meet the bar that the Schempp case set. It's hard to describe most of these courses as objective or as having a secular purpose. What really astonishes me about what I found with Texas public school high school level courses is that it's the same issues that Ellery was dealing with in 1963. The exact same things that Ellery talked about tonight, what he was concerned about back in 1956, 1958, 1963, still a problem in public school. Most Texas Bible courses assumed that the only Bible was the Protestant Bible. No attention to the fact that the Roman Catholic Bible has books that aren't in the Protestant Bible, that Eastern Orthodox Bibles have books that aren't in the Protestant Bible, that the Jewish Bible is quite different from Christian Bibles. There's no New Testament, for starters. There's nothing old about the Old Testament. They don't use that terminology. The contents are arranged differently. The books have different names. Many Texas Bible courses completely miss these basic differences. If they assign a particular tradition, a particular translation, what translation do you think it is? It's usually the King James. Bloodshed in 1844 over the emphasis on the King James because it's associated with particular religious traditions. Not everybody uses the King James, but that's often the required course. The required translation. Ellery talked about how the Bible verses that were read over the intercom often seem to be read to promote particular religious beliefs. Very often, Texas Bible courses promote particular religious beliefs, sometimes very explicitly. The idea that salvation comes from Christianity alone, that the Bible is divinely inspired, that the Bible is historically accurate in every way. There would be nothing, I'll be clear, there would be nothing wrong with a public school course saying some groups have this religious view about the Bible. And you need to know that for civic literacy, that the belief in the Bible's reliability is a very important defining characteristic of some religious groups and not others. Creation science, pseudoscience. Pseudoscientific racism. The idea that modern races are somehow descended from the sons of Noah. Urban legends. The idea that NASA found a missing day and time that corresponds to the story of the sun standing still in Joshua 10. This is an urban legend, but it makes its way into Texas Bible classes. Of the 60 courses that I looked at in 2011-2012, About 50 of them, I think, would have a difficult time if someone were to take them to court. Now, I'm happy to report that about 10 of them seem to hit the bar that Schempp had set. They relied on resources drawn from a broad spectrum of the religious community, not just from one particular faith community. They were intentional in informing students about very different Bibles, the different religious traditions used. They were sensitive to the ways different religious communities interpret Scripture. They recognized that biblical texts are important historical sources without lapsing into a tone of assumed historical accuracy, which is a very different thing. They were able to discuss the Bible's moral and theological claims without presenting them as authoritative. They acknowledged that the Bible is not a science textbook, not even in Texas. And they treated Judaism as a religion in its own right and not just a foil for Christianity. But those forces were a minority. They weren't the norm. Of course, the whole issue of Bible courses should raise the issue of why have courses devoted solely to the Bible when there typically aren't courses devoted to other aspects or expressions of religion. There typically aren't distinct courses devoted to other religious traditions that don't rely on the Bible at all. Even having Bible courses sends the message that some religious traditions, those that rely on some form of the Bible, are more worthy of study than are other traditions. So I would say that we still have our work cut out for us in learning how to meet that goal of Schempp, of studying about religion in a way that's done objectively for a secular program of education. But the fact that we even have that as a goal is partly because of Ellery's courage. The fact that we distinguish between teaching religion and teaching about religion in public schools as part of the legacy of Ellery. Thank you.
Thank you. Professor Chancey, I have added one comment up here at the very end, which was George McCoy and Tommy Williams' explanation of his Bible bill. Can you comment upon this and whether similar statements have been used to rationalize or justify the similar courses that have been taught here in Texas?
Absolutely. I'm so glad that you've got this particular example, because Texas passed a bill promoting Bible courses in 2007. And the Texas bill used a law passed by the state of Georgia a year earlier as its basis. So this law from Georgia was the foundation for the Texas Bible law. And you'll see, just in the terminology, the types of problems that I'm talking about, that emphasis on the Old and New Testaments. Well, you know, the use of Old Testament is a term that privileges the Christian Bible over Jewish Bibles. Most scholars now use the terminology of, most scholars in a non-sectarian setting, would use the terminology of Hebrew Bible rather than a term that Jews reject. Note also that six or seven lines down, it talks about the customs and cultures of the peoples and societies recorded in the Old and New Testaments. Well, the language of recorded sure does sound like somebody's sitting down and taking notes as it happened. And you know, the Bible reflects the cultures that produced it, of course, but reflects is a very different word than recorded suggests. The influence of the Old and New Testaments, the influence of the Bible upon different shared culture, I think is a worthy goal, but I think even the terminology used here reflects a lack of awareness of diverse religious views, even among those communities that hold something called the Bible as important.
Now, in your analysis of the programs that are offered in schools with respect to the issue of the, you know, examining in an objective way the cultures and customs of peoples and societies recorded in the Old and New Testaments, did you find any programs that dealt with the cultures and societies and religious beliefs of, say, the Hittites or the Roman Empire or Hellenistic Greeks?
You know, my studies I did, which are tfn.org/Bible courses, were solely on Bible courses. So to talk about other religions, we have to look more or less in other social studies courses. We have to see what people are actually teaching there. But we've just been through a long round of textual battles over how different traditions are presented, whether ancient religions or contemporary religions. And I would say that that too is an area where we need some work in Texas.
Very good. Professor Chancey, thank you again for coming down here. And now, questions from the audience, and let me just ask that whoever is going to be here in the audience speak very loudly so that these gentlemen can be heard on the microphone that you've got. Yes.
Okay, I've asked this several times. I think we all agree that the business of government has nothing to do with religion. And why do we have a God we trust on our money, and why are both houses of Congress open with a prayer every day?
Because it's a big mistake.
And what are we going to do about it?
The idea of prayers in Congress has started at a very early time. I don't think it's really worthwhile or important. The original motto of the United States was "I pluribus unum," and that lasted up through the Civil War. But there was people study the history of religious movements in this country. They're known as the Great Awakenings. There were three of them, maybe we're in the fourth one. And the second Great Awakening was the middle of the 19th century, and it had many. I cannot give up a whole historical account of it in 2 minutes. But there was an agreement made with Abraham Lincoln that they would support him in the Civil War if he agreed to make some concessions to the religious movements of that time. So in 1875, they agreed to make put under God on the coins, not on the paper money, but on the coins. And it was only in that year, incidentally, that Christmas became a national holiday. Christmas has been just December 25th has been just an ordinary day. Congress met on December 25th. The Puritans banned it in Boston. And this is pagan. So this whole notion that from the earliest days in the United States was enmeshed and completely in Christianity was just not true. In fact, Cambridge, Massachusetts has the honor of introducing the Christmas tree, another pagan custom. Carl Fulton is a German who came to the United States, and he brought the Germanic custom of having a Tannenbaum with candles on it, and he introduced it in his Cambridge home. People thought that was kind of neat, and a lot of people went out and bought Christmas trees. My partner, Arlene, and I don't really think very much about virgin births and Christmas and that sort of thing, but we do like winter solstice. So we have a winter solstice tree every year. It looks remarkably like a Christmas tree. And we always buy it from the Carl Fallen Unitarian Universalist Church in Lexington, Massachusetts. So that keeps alive the honor of the memory of Carl Fallen, who introduced the Christmas tree and paganism into American Christmas. And I'll make one more comment about under God and the pledge. The Pledge of Allegiance, you know, was never recited by Lincoln or Jefferson or Madison or George Washington, because it wasn't written until 1892. It was written by a socialist minister named Bellamy. And it was never very important. He printed it in a little magazine called Boy's Life. It was sort of related to what became Boy Scouts. Nobody paid much attention to it until all the patriotic fervor of World War I. And then they wanted to have a Pledge of Allegiance. Okay, fine. And the phrase, one nation, indivisible, was put in original version to counter the idea of the Civil War, of divided nation, okay? That was important. But anyhow, and after World War II, of course, we were involved in the Cold War, and the Knights of Columbus, which is a Catholic lay organization, wanted to distinguish us from the godless atheist communists, and so they thought that our Pledge of Allegiance should have the phrase, under God. So they managed to get this passed in 1954, I remember it very well. We were in school then, and you know, it was something we started to be citing the pledge in a slightly different fashion. When the pledge was passed this way, the entire Congress marched out of the halls of Congress onto the front steps to raise the flag, singing Onward Christian Soldiers, and then recited the new version of the pledge. So I do want to point out to you that we are not one nation under God. If you look on a map, we're actually under Canada.
I can't add much to that. I'll try. Ellery's point about how complicated the relationship has been between church and state from the beginning is so on target. And I think the one thing that I would add is just the historical reminder that before the Constitution and in early American history, a lot of the states had established churches. They were used to doing government rituals that had religious elements because that's what they always done. And when we got the Constitution and then the Bill of Rights, these old habits, they continued. You know, eventually all the states disestablished their churches, but these religious elements were never purged, so to speak. And from the very beginning, when it came to how to, whether to incorporate religious elements into these types of civic and civil practices, we have followed a zigzag path from the very beginning.
And I would point out one more thing about we're taking.
One more point about the founding fathers and the various Bibles. Everybody should know of the existence of the Jefferson Bible.
Yes.
This was Thomas Jefferson's work, and he cut out all references to supernatural events. So it ought to be right up there with the King James, and it's important. It's available on the internet, by the way.
And before we take the next question, I'll throw in one other comment. If you ever heard Bill Riley talking about the war on Christmas and who had begun the war on Christmas, the answer was the Mayflower Pilgrims, because for them it was a secular day, since Christmas was, according to their analysis, not a part of the Bible and therefore not a part of the Christian Commonwealth, but instead a secular day, Saturnalia, the old Roman holiday. And so William Bradford, author of Plymouth Plantation, was there and actually was chastising and punishing those members of the original Pilgrim Society who were choosing not to work on Christmas Day because they claimed it to be a holiday. He said, no, you either work or you pray on that day. So, to answer the riot who made war on Christmas, why aren't the same folks who brought you turkey every Thanksgiving? Next question, sir.
Would you comment on why most of our religious holidays or ceremonies seem to fall on or very close to either equinoxes or solstices?
I never thought about it, to be honest. I do want to point out that paganism actually infuses our language and our society completely. We have Sunday, which is the day of the sun. We have Monday, which is the day of the moon. Tuesday is named after an obscure Teutonic god. Wednesday is Woden's day. Thursday is Thor's day. Right? Saturday, Saturnalia, Saturn. Right? So the days of the week are very pagan. And if you're really Christian, you shouldn't use them.
Easter falls very close to the spring equinox.
Right.
Yep.
And you can go on down the list. Virtually all of them that I've researched find that the religious ceremonies fall on or very close to either the winter solstice or the summer solstice or the vernal or autumnal equinox.
Right, and that holds true across philosophy, and it's precisely for the reasons that you all are articulating, right? There have always been groups that have had holidays in relation to equinoxes and astronomical phenomena, as well as with harvest seasons, because Judaism and Christianity were so influential, particularly in our society. We use those holidays, and they themselves have been grafted onto, in some cases, earlier agricultural festivals. This is true with Jewish holidays, for example. The meaning is tied to biblical stories, but they often have a pre-biblical story agricultural basis. So, and that type of thing holds true across culturally.
And we remember we used to have lots of different gods. We had a god of rain, god of fertility. After all, the spring festivals all have to do with fertility and the renewal of land and making babies and many things. People sometimes say that monotheism was a great advance in civilization. Well, I'm not quite so sure about all that. Why have one single God that is involved in everything? In the bad old days, in the good old days, if it didn't rain, you knew exactly who to complain to. That was the rain god. If the cross didn't come up, you knew exactly who to complain to. Now you have to upset the entire universe just to get your foot in the door.
Yes, sir.
Yes. A member of the State Board of Education in Texas insisted on putting in the Texas textbooks the comment that Moses was the originator of the state of the national constitution. And I don't know if that ever made it into a textbook or not.
Well, wasn't there some benighted Texan congresswoman who said that if English was good enough for Jesus, then it's good enough for us?
Some of the textbooks that were approved emphasize what they call the biblical origins of democratic republican ideals. And it's one of those textbooks gives Moses quite a bit of attention for the influence of his ideas. This idea of Moses as providing the legal system, that's the foundation of the American governmental system, gained a lot of steam after the Charlton Heston movie came out, because a fraternal organization began placing Ten Commandments monuments across the country. This raised Ten Commandments consciousness. So it actually is in some of the social studies textbooks, in a particular form, and it's an oversimplification, to say the least.
And I'd like to add one more point here. Go to the internet, Google, and type in 613 commandments. You will find that there's a list of 613 commandments that are in the Jewish Bible, and you don't follow very many of them, I bet, but they're there. So the Ten Commandments are only a small fraction out of the whole 613.
Yes.
Has there been any attempt for legislation that you know of, Professor Chancey, to forbid the enforcement of the Texas Constitution forbidding religion in the Texas schools?
Okay, can you repeat that one last time? Has there been any legislation
proposed that you know of, or have you cooperated on any, to enforce the Texas Constitution, which forbids religion in the public schools?
Right. Any legislation to enforce more stringently the Texas Constitution that prohibits the promotion of religion in public schools.
And the expenditure for...
of government funds. Is that what you're going to?
Yes.
Yes, the expenditure of government funds to do so. You know, the traditional line of argument, I don't know of any such legislation. The tradition, perhaps, as a church state lawyer, you might think something here that I'm not.
That Church versus Bullock decision of 1908 came when various two Jewish people, two essentially Unitarian freethinkers, and two Roman Catholics, cited the provisions of the Texas Constitution, which go back to 1836, about no secular expenditures for any church or other establishment of religion. And they used that to challenge, not the First Amendment, not the 14th Amendment, they used the Texas Constitution to challenge the use of the King James Bible in Texas. Because, as many people will remember, the founders of the folks who got together at Washington and Brazos in 1836, while the Alamo was under siege, had had an experience of church-state unity, and that was compelled Catholicization of American, largely Protestant settlers here. And so, if you look at the 1836 Constitution, it reflects, you know, a condemnation of the Catholic clergy and the requirements for Catholic uniformity. But the Texas Supreme Court rejected that, as opposed to Ellery's attorneys. The attorneys who brought that case against the Coarse Canyon Independent School District did not go through the sort of evidentiary standards necessary to actually show that the King James Bible was not the only Bible out there. They cited cases, but they did not come up with expert witnesses, and they did not make a full evidentiary showing that would have at least educated the three very Protestant, very King James Bible worshiping members of the Texas Supreme Court in 1908. So, undeveloped record, and the Texas Supreme Court held that those provisions would not bar those constitutional provisions going back to the founding fathers of Davy Crockett and Sam Houston would not bar the use of the King James Bible in public schools.
Let me connect some dots between Philadelphia 1844, Washington, Madras, Abington, Texas 2015, and I'll do it with the term non-sectarian. When I use the term non-sectarian, I mean not promoting the religious ideas of any particular religious sect over another. Any sect, any tradition, non-sectarian. Historically, the term has not always been used that way. And so in the 1844 Philadelphia Bible riots, when Texas was founded, in the 1908 Texas case, non-sectarian was understood to mean not promoting any particular Protestant denomination over another. And so there's this deep-rooted understanding of the term non-sectarian to mean generically Protestant. And that is embedded very, very deeply in our culture. It's okay to be, the mindset goes, to be vaguely, generically Protestant. That's not promoting anything. And it has often been Roman Catholics and Jews and Unitarians and freethinkers and agnostics who have said, well, actually, that's not very non-sectarian. Historically, until the past 30 years, Baptists have been at the front of that as well. Baptists used to be, many Baptists still are, staunch defenders of church-state separation. Of course, since immigration changes in the 1960s, we can't talk anymore about simply Protestant, Catholic, Jew, agnostic, atheist, right? Now we need to think about Muslim, Hindu, Buddhist, Sikh, across the board. But there's still that assumption, sometimes in legislation, sometimes in jurisprudence, that a vague generic Protestantism is okay. And I think that's a problem.
Now, we started a few minutes late to allow the last few people to come in, so we'll run a few minutes past 9 o'clock. Let me take, yes, sir, question from you.
A comment and question real quick. Karen Armstrong's book on religion and violence has a really interesting section on the 1800s and the 1900s in the development of these issues you're talking about in fundamentalism and Protestantism. I recommend that book, and I recommend those ideas to everyone. But I know we're talking mainly about the state of Texas, but my question is, the Roberts Court has made some very interesting, I will say some unexpected decisions on an array of issues in the last few years. Do you see any First Amendment issues that are currently in the pipeline, or cases in the pipeline, that may end up in the court, and have there been any indication of the way the court may vote on these issues that are coming up?
Well, already there have been a couple of very bad decisions. The Greece decision about allowing prayers before city council meetings, and even the worst is the Hobby Lobby decision that allows the certain factions of the religious right, Catholic Church in particular, to and evangelicals, to claim religious exemption. Well, I just don't believe in this kind of religious exemption. I mean, if the law against child labor is correct for society, then everybody has to obey it. You can't pick and choose which laws based on religion. So it's not religious freedom, it's religious coercion. And I'll just make this point. I don't believe in religious freedom, or at least not in the way that it's ordinarily used. You don't have the freedom, complete freedom, just because you believe something, to have child sacrifice. You don't have the religious freedom to have a prayer meeting in the middle of a crowded freeway. There's limitations on religious freedom, and we think we ought to recognize it. This whole notion that the country is founded on religious freedom is nonsense. It's freedom founded on people being very ambitious and trying to get new land, and obviously to assist the Puritans came to escape a certain kind of oppression. But I mean, to elevate the idea of religious freedom as being the foundation of the country is just nonsense.
The broader question about the Supreme Court, I don't know. But
try my best to talk about things I actually know about. Okay. And I'm not a person with a lawyer.
I'm not limited that way.
Well, no, my point is I study biblical studies, and I study religion and public education. So those are the things that I can talk about in most comments. Would you have a different view on religious freedom if it were used in a more nuanced term that you were talking about, as a freedom that has limits the way other freedoms do, and more historical precision, so that, right, this myth that we often hear in some political quarters about the nation being founded for the sake of religious freedom? I mean, it's oversimplified. What about a more nuanced history of how notions of religious freedom developed?
I mean, well, of course, I believe that people should be free to have their own thoughts, and that having your own thoughts in the dark of the night is rather different from what you actually go out and practice. A rather different thing. And all whatever your thoughts are, whatever your beliefs are, you don't have the right to impose them on anybody else. That's a very important distinction. And you should not be trying to get the power of government to enforce your religious beliefs over other people's beliefs. And that's, of course, something that religions and churches have always done throughout history. They've always tried to capture the power of government for their own benefit and their own advantage. We have to remember that churches already get an enormous number of advantages. They have this tax exemption. Priests and preachers, of which there are about some 91,000 in this country, have reduced tax burdens from the rest of us. And the whole situation seems to me to be unbalanced in favor of religions and not in favor of secular society.
And we have one final question. Yes, right there.
Students should know that. The Bible was an important resource in the American experience for abolitionists to turn to the passages of the prophets for inspiration to argue that everybody deserves freedom. We turn to Genesis to say that all people are created equal, whether from Africa or from Europe, whether white or black, that's important. That book gives almost no attention at all to all the passages that say slaves obey their masters. You know, it gives no attention at all to the fact that slaveholders were also quoting the scripture to defend slavery, and they often had a better argument on exegetical grounds. Right? Meaning slaves obey their masters is a very straightforward verse to interpret. So even that company has some room for growth. That is mildly. Why are there more textbooks? The market is interesting, but it's not stable. Nobody knows exactly how many of these courses there are. They come, they go. It's not like a big niche of the market where a publisher could get in there and know that it was always going to have a steady stream of buyers. So resources are an area. My professional society, the Society of Biblical Literature, is actually trying to develop resources that will help teachers who want to do this in a way that is respectful to religious difference and academically informed. But it's a slow, it's a long-term goal. I would also note the Society of Biblical Literature has resources. The First Amendment Center has resources on how to do this. It's a very important organization. Also the New Zealand, would be an important resource.
And with that, we are past 9 o'clock, but I wanted to thank our two distinguished and very articulate guests. And I'd like to thank Nancy Freeman, president of our local chapter, American United Separation Conference State, and all of the members of the board for bringing an exciting evening of intelligent discussion about an issue that frequently is not the subject of intelligent discussion. This, I think, is the promise of the Americans United, that they will bring people of all sides and will address these issues for the benefit of the people. Thank you for your time. Thank you for coming here tonight.